Hi, everyone.
Hi. It's amazing to see so many people here. Just one more time, I'm going to have anyone, if you have an empty seat next to you, can you raise your hand? Any empty seats? Okay, I guess we are full. Cool. Well, welcome to our Zell Visiting Writers Series reading and Q&A with Ross Gay. My name, My name is Shawnee, and I'm your host for this season. In case you don't yet know about our programming and what we do, the Helen Zell Writers Program brings 12 acclaimed authors to the University of Michigan each year to meet with our students and give public readings, craft talks, and Q&As, and the series is generously funded by Helen Zell and Janie Lack. I have just a few administrative announcements before we move towards the reading. Please note that this event is recorded and will be posted on the Zell Visiting Writers Series YouTube channel where anyone can watch later on. Please refrain from taking any photos before or after the reading, which includes during the book signing. If you are joining us on Zoom, closed captioning is enabled, which you can turn on or off by pressing the CC icon on the bottom of your Zoom screen. We'll also post a copy of Ross's reading in the Zoom chat shortly. And for the order of tonight's event, in just a minute, MFA student Amanda Hayes will introduce Ross. After that, Ross will give a reading for about 30 minutes. Around 6 p.m., another MFA student, Arrow Mandel, will have a 20-minute conversation with Ross. And for the last 10 minutes, we'll open it up to audience questions. So you can line up at the mics, which are on either side of the room. Or if you need a mic walk to you, please just raise your hand and we'll get you one. Zoom participants can submit their questions through the Q&A function, and we will read them aloud on your behalf. And now I'll hand it over to Amanda for an introduction.
Ross Gay made me love basketball. His book-length poem, Beholding, follows Dr. J's unprecedented and miraculous baseline scoop in the 1980 NBA Finals. And yes, I did have to look up most of those things the first time I read the book. Of course, the book's about a lot more than that. It's about virtuosity and community and blackness. It's about pain, especially black pain, the ways it is punished and commodified, the ways it is miraculously held. It's about the difference between looking and beholding. It's about how to hold others and how to be beholden to them. Midway through the poem, Ross punctures the narrative with a series of questions. What's my study? What's my practice? What are we trading in? What are we looking at? If I may be so bold, I would say Ross's practice is a practice of attention, of tending to the world around him. I have a confession, which is that before this week, I'd only read a few dozen pages of his prose. I borrowed the Book of Delights from Shawnee and sat down yesterday morning with the intention of reading the whole thing through so that I would be very well prepared to introduce a writer whose work has changed my life and I'm sure has changed many of yours. I read a few essays and found very urgently that I could not finish it. Instead, the essays demanded that I get up and plod around my apartment. I grabbed my computer and noticed fat flakes of snow drifting onto my driveway. I thought about my brother, who that morning had sent me a video of snow out his window in Pennsylvania. Then I started writing this. People love to ask what writing, and especially what poetry, can do. I've always been averse to the question, skeptical of its demand for utility, and anxious about whether there's any good answer at all. But when I read Ross's work, I have no question about what writing can do. His writing attends to the world. It delights and enjoys and honors, and it does these things not by ignoring, but by holding grief, injury, and injustice. This careful attention, this holding and beholding, is the firmest form of grace. It is a devotion to the world and to the beings in it. It is something Ross teaches us how to do in his writing again and again. Ross Gay has written 4 books of poetry and 3 essay collections, the most recent of which is titled The Book of More Delights. He likes bright colors and is a co-founder of the Bloomington Community Orchard. Please help me welcome him to the stage.
Thank you. How are you? Good to see you. Good to see you. Thank you for that. That was beautiful. I'm so glad to be here. I was like walking around and trying to think of the first time I was here. And I kept on being like, oh no, I was here before that. I was, you know, like, I have this deep kind of connection, beloved, so many beloveds here. And like, also like things that matter in my kind of writing community, writing life. The first time I was here, it was Poetry Night Ann Arbor. Jeff Cass, yeah. And me and Patrick Rozal were among others, were out, brought out. But it was like, it just felt so important to me. I saw Jeff Cass in the hallway who brought me. Thank you, Jeff. I'm just so happy to be here. I'm going to read a little bit from that poem, Beholding. I always love it when people who are like, yeah, I'm not into basketball, but they're like, but I read the book, you know, so generous. So anyway, I'm going to read, you know, like 15 minutes of that. And then I'm going to read this one other poem. So I'm going to pretend like I'm actually going to notice what my clock is doing. I always do this. I look at my watch and then I promptly forget what it says. So it says 6:46. It just fell out off. So, okay, whatever. We'll just. Where we end in 15 minutes is where we end. Bound in gratitude. This poem does not exist without the work and ideas and words of many, many writers and thinkers. Among them, Amiri Baraka, Garnett Cadogan, Toy Derricotte, Adeseli Skirmay, Saidiya Hartman, Allen Iverson, Fred Moten, Kevin Quashie, Patrick Rosal, Christina Sharp, and Susan Sontag, by which I mean the work and thinking and care and words are indebted to them and are sometimes actually theirs. There's an about Dr. J that you can read on your own. It's just basically me explaining about how when I was talking about when younger folks would be like, what are you working on? I'd say, this poem about Dr. J, and they'd be like, who? Dr. J was a basketball player in the 1970s and 80s. And there's an epigraph to the poem. To be held, to behold. Christina Sharp, in the wake on blackness and being. Yes. Beholding, April 4th, 2015, till today. And you might have noticed there's nowhere to go. The wind cutting little eddies at your collarbones and behind your ear. As Dr. J drives from the foul line extended to the baseline, defended valiantly by Mark Landsberger, who, in this poem, despite the doofy urge to make him so, is not allegorical, but is rather simply a hardworking journeyman ball player with decent athleticism and size and a floppy mop of dusty blonde hair got caught up in the gust, sliding his size 16s quick so that Doc, after catching the ball at the elbow and taking one hard dribble to the baseline where the dunk would usually commence, could not access the paint or the lane or the key, which is what we call the area nearest the goal, which in this case is an iron hole drawn in space and therefore implies also a window, though the key makes it a door, that Landsberger, it seemed, was trying to keep shut. And so Doc left. He left his feet, which means more or less jumping with the ball with nowhere to go, and which were warned against by coaches from day one for the ensuing requisite stupid pass, or more simply, though no less stupid, travel, also called walking, which the leaping often leads to. Keep your feet! Again and again, which makes the leaping, leaving your feet, sound sacrificial. The way in certain places, certain countries or countries inside of countries, you must leave by foot with nowhere to go, which there is. And Doc, you should note, after the one dribble, clasped the ball with only his right hand without once at all in any shape or form using the left, which, among other things, friends, differentiates this from all the descendant moves. Kevin Durant, Dwayne Wade, Steph, and Giannis, and Harden, and Kawhi. Yes, Bron too. I shall not be moved. And using only one hand, which is amazing, but not yet miraculous, more a physical and therefore genetic fact. Thanks, Ma and Pa Irving. Doc's hand becomes an octopus gripping the ball, nothing like prey, and with that ball snugged in his mitt, Doc maybe kind of sort of thought something like, I'm going to put this schmuck, the schmuck in this case being Landsberger, though do not please revert to a simplistic allegorization of the journeyman, which word I repeat advisedly, on a poster. Though schmuck is a word I'd be surprised to hear Doc say, and the word posterize, common usage, posterize his ass. You might be thinking, there's a bit of an anachronism in this poem, in this move, which ostensibly occurred in the 1980 NBA Finals, though we all know that nothing happens only when it happens. We all know nothing happens only when it happens. Emerging more in the epic, which in the NBA lasts 3 to 5 years, following Doc's retirement, Neek and Jordan, Hakeem the Dream and Clyde the Glide, Barkley the Glove, and yo, remember Sean Kemp? Rain Man. Though Doc probably thought it anyway, visionary that he was, when will they verb what I keep doing to these schmucks, especially Bill fucking Walton? Driving from the foul line extended toward the baseline as the unsuspecting Landsberger, who did a fine job of shuffling his size 16s and not holding, keeping Irving from the key, and who must for a scant and fleeting moment had felt a degree of pride when Doc, after that hard dribble right, left his feet with nowhere to go. Billy Cunningham, the coach on the sideline, his hands on his hips, his sport coat thrown open, a few strands of hair stuck to his moist pink brow, and almost smiling as Doc began sailing out of bounds over the baseline. And Landsberger, a solid leaper, skied and foreclosed the possibility of Doc sneaking a shot in this side of the basket, by which I mean dunking probably quite hard, by putting his hand against the backboard. A big door swinging shut, at which fine and commendable defensive effort, Irving simply decided in the air to knock on other doors by soaring more. Have you ever decided anything in the air? Turtling his head into his chest so as not to bash it against the backboard, flying like that, in fact, now, behind the basket and backboard where Kareem, a good help defender, Kareem, one of the best defenders of all time, 5-time NBA All-Defensive First Team, 6-time NBA All-Defensive Second Team, 6 MVPs, sorry, MJ, not to mention, which means it requires mentioning, Kareem was one of those Negroes they changed the rules for, banning the dunk for years from the NCAA, which is to say banning emphatic and exquisite flight, which maybe explains the wise and sort of tired eyes of Kareem, one of the best basketball players of all time, who had slid to also cut off the baseline, which he accomplished, but found himself now looking into the sky directly out of bounds, which his own suddenly unfamiliar body must have been telling him was so weird. This is so weird. Looking and looking like this, his hands extended timidly, a silver maple's branches creaking and swaying in a hurricane, for Doc was amongst the trees, as we call the big men like Kareem, the trees, who reside mostly in the lane or in the key, growing there, rooting the thousands of fans now holding their breath, looking into the sky, some of their hands reaching out instinctively toward their neighbors beside them, or their palms instinctively laying on the shoulders before them, or forearms shoved gently into a wrist or hip beside them. A few of them, their arms locked as if going for a stroll, the whole of the Philadelphia spectrum become a kind of dew-glistened web, shivering its gems in the gales as Irving went higher. And now began to extend his right hand in a precise arc, beginning precisely above his head, painting a broad and precise circle, not unlike Leonardo's Vitruvian Man in his hula hoop of perfect proportions. If that little naked man wasn't little or naked and was palming a basketball and was flying through the trees. And I find myself again and again with my arm making the perfectly impossible circle again and again as I watch this clip on YouTube frame by frame, clumsily on a computer with gummy keys and a post-it note covering the eye hole scrawled discipline on April 5th, 2015 at 1:48 a.m. again and again thinking, what am I looking at? What am I seeing? Back to the first long step toward the baseline, the slight contact with Landsberger, the leap again, long step, contact, leap again, long step, contact, leap again, long step, contact, leap. And I noticed this time in the background, which is granted hazy, this being old footage and my eyes a bit roomy for the now nearly 2 hours studying this clip, I noticed that about the foul line, Silk, AKA Jamal Wilkes, who, for the record, Coach Wooden on the record said was his best player ever at UCLA, not Kareem and oh fuck forever Bill Walton. And it's worthwhile to spend at least a moment with the name Silk, among the finest nicknames in basketball, implying an ease and fluidity of movement, implying a difficult thing, a painful thing made to look easy, a fiber prized for its softness, its smoothness on the skin, gathered from captive worms fed mulberry leaves. My court name was Beast, for what it's worth. And after a summer league game on the court at 10th and Lombard, where those in the know would slide through a gap in the grimace of the wrought iron gate to get in, a court that would be in time shut down in the most heinous of ways, removing the rims, the backboards lonely as gravestones, because of complaints to the city from the condo owners across the street, who did not want to hear, God forbid, all that Negro gathering and celebration and care and delight every goddamn weekend morning, all that frolic and tumult, all that flight. Why can't they just go someplace else? A slightly older opponent told me he was holding my hand and shoulder and pulling me close. He was holding me beneath the stately oaks overhanging the court, looking down kindly on us and time to time blocking a high arcing shot and wishing a leaf or two upon the ex-ballers on the sidelines, reading the Philadelphia Inquirer, sipping coffee, debating and laughing or acting stupid like refs making calls. Oh yeah, he walked his ass off. The oaks dappling the old heads and their discourse, the best line of verse I will ever write. His shirt soaked through, staring at me to be sure I was listening, which I was then as now. You ain't no beast. You ain't no beast. You're a man, you hear me? And I noticed Silk's right leg and hip twitch before relaxing with what might have been the body's, aw, shit. Though if you look closely again and again in a certain kind of way, again and again, you'll also see what might be a kind of light descending upon Silk's high cheekbones and forehead again and again, unfurling almost across his face as he cranes his neck toward the soaring until you'd almost swear tonight at 2:26 a.m. he was looking into a tree strewn with people, the human-shaped shadows twisting across his body, the legs swaying into his torso, a gray hand burning across his face and resting for a second at his ear. The peaky pinky become a beak from which wheezed a tiny song. You'd swear watching this sliver of the clip again and again, the shadow of one man's head seeming to lay itself on Silk's chest, for which in the clip you will see Silk make of his arm a cradle, lowering his head as though to say, I'm sorry, I'm so sorry. With which the tree makes a kind of choir moaning, I'm so sorry, twisting its roots in the molder with what they've been made to do. Wait, wait, what am I looking at? What am I practicing? It's not that. No, no, it's not that. It's late. My eyes are playing tricks, for this is like the biggest uncle at the biggest family reunion, holding in its flung open arms nine guys, both raucous and rapt, hollering and smacking hands and holding each other, cooing like lovebirds for the flight they're amidst in one of the house's best seats at Rucker Park in Harlem, where the young, as yet unpseudonymous Julius Irving, just a college kid from UMass, has begun his extended course of study on gravity and grace. I'll stop there.
Thank you. Thank you.
I kept with the, I watched the clock. It was so bizarre. I managed it. And I'm just going to read this poem, called Catalog of Unabashed Gratitude. And it's fun because I think one of the times I was here, I read this poem. Anything you need to know? You know, there's a, I mentioned a community orchard in this poem in Bloomington. There's a orchard called the Bloomington Community Orchard. Good name. And it's this beautiful project. It was started by my friend, Amy Countryman. And she was this cool, like for those of you who are students or otherwise too, she was an undergraduate, like a slightly older undergraduate, and her thesis project, she was doing like environmental studies or something. Her thesis project was about food security, and she kind of surveyed the urban canopy, the trees that the city was managing, and found that like almost none of them are food or, you know, food producing trees. And so she just sort of like did her research and figured like, oh, like one little intervention into this would be an urban orchard. So she, her advisor took her thesis to the urban forester, Lee Huss, and he said, you know, go, it's a good project. If you can kind of show community support, we'll let you use this acre. So she had a call out meeting, you know, I don't know, 100 people showed up or something. We very quickly sort of turned into these teams and stuff. It's so fun because it was like one of these like, projects where people are trying very hard not to be hierarchical. So we're like, kind of like, what are we even like, what are we going to call the groups? You know, we're not going to call them committees. We're going to call them, you know. And then, you know, after much, maybe that'll come up in the Q&A, but after much sort of beautiful, inefficient, sloppy struggle, there came an orchard, you know, and there's an orchard there that you can go visit. And those trees now are like 12 years old, some of them. Catalog of Unabashed Gratitude. Friends, will you bear with me today? For I have awakened from a dream in which a robin made with its shabby wings a kind of veil, behind which it shimmied and stomped something from the south of Spain, its breast aflare, looking me dead in the eye from the branch that grew into my window, coochie-cooing my chin. The bird shuffling its little talons left and then right, while the leaves bristled against the plaster wall, two of them drifting onto my blanket, while the bird opened and closed her wings like a matador giving up on murder, jutting her beak, turning a circle and flashing again the ruddy bombast of her breast, by which I knew upon waking she was telling me in no uncertain terms to bellow forth the tubas and sousaphones, the whole rusty brass band of gratitude not quite dormant in my belly. She said so in a human voice. Bellow forth. And who among us could ignore such odd and precise counsel? Hear ye, hear ye. I am here to holler that I have hauled tons, by which I don't mean lots. I mean tons of cow shit, and stood ankle deep in swales of maggots swirling the spent beer grains the brewery man was good enough to dump off, holding his nose where they smell very bad, would make the compost writhe giddy and lick its lips, twirling dung with my pitchfork again and again with hundreds and hundreds of other people. We dreamt an orchard this way, furrowing our brows and hauling our wheelbarrows and sweating through our shirts. And 2 years later, there was a party at which trees were sunk into the well-fed earth, one of which, a Liberty apple, after being watered in, was tamped by a baby barefoot with a bow hanging from her hair, biting her lip in her joyous work. And friends, this is the realest place I know. It makes me squirm like a worm. I am so grateful. You could ride your bike there or roller skate. You could catch the bus. There's a fence and a gate twisted by hand. There is a fig tree taller than you in Indiana. It will make you gasp. It might make you want to stay alive even. Thank you. And thank you for not taking my pal when the engine of his mind dragged him to swig fistfuls of Xanax and a bottle or two of booze. And thank you for taking my father a few years after his own father went down. Thank you, Mercy. Mercy, thank you. For not smoking meth with your mother, oh, thank you. Thank you for leaving and for coming back. And thank you for what inside my friend's love bursts like a throng of roadside goldenrod gleaming into the world, likely hauling a shovel with her like one named Erily Ott, with hands big as a horse's, and who, like one named Erily Ott, will laugh time to time till the juice runs from her nose. Oh, thank you for the way a small thing's wail makes the milk, or what once was milk in us, gather into horses huckle buckling across the field. And thank you, friends, when last spring the hyacinth bells rang and the crocuses flaunted their upturned skirts, and a quiet roved the beehive, which when I entered were snugged two or three fist-sized clutches of bees between the frames, almost clinging to one another. This one's tiny head pushed into another's tiny wing, one's forelegs resting on another's face, the translucent paper of their wings fluttering beneath my breath. And when a few dropped to the frames beneath, honey. And after falling down to cry, everything's glacial shine. And thank you too. And thanks for the corduroy couch I have put you on. Put your feet up. Here's a light blanket, a pillow, dear ones, for I can feel this is going to be long. I can't stop my gratitude, which includes, dear reader, you for staying here with me, for moving your lips just so as I speak. Here is a cup of tea. I have spooned honey into it. And thank you, the tiny bee's shadow perusing these words as I write them. And the way my love talks quietly when in the hive. So quietly, in fact, you cannot hear her, but only notice barely her lips moving in conversation. Thank you, what does not scare her in me, but makes her reach my way. Thank you, the love she is, which hurts sometimes. And the time she misremembered elephants in one of my poems, which, oh, here they come. Garlanded with morning glory and wisteria blooms, trombones all the way down to the river. Thank you, the quiet in which the river bends around the elephant's solemn trunk, polishing stones, floating on its gentle back, the flock of geese flying overhead. And to the quick and gentle flocking of men to the old lady falling down on the corner of Fairmount and 18th, holding patiently with the softest parts of their hands her cane and purple hat, gathering for her the contents of her purse and touching her shoulder and elbow. Thank you, too, the cockeyed basketball court on which In a half court, 3-on-3, we old heads made of some runny nose kids a shambles. And the 61-year-old, after flipping a reverse layup off a backdoor cut from my no-look pass to seal the game, ripped off his shirt and threw punches at the gods and hollered at the kids to admire the pacemaker's scar grinning across his chest. Thank you, the glad accordion's wheeze in the chest. Thank you, the bagpipes. Thank you to the woman barefoot in a gaudy dress for stopping her car in the middle of the road and the tractor trailer behind her and the van behind it, whisking a turtle off the road. Thank you, God of gaudy. Thank you, paisley panties. Thank you, the organ up my dress. Thank you, the sheer dress you wore kneeling in my dream at the creek's edge and the light swimming through it. The koi kissing halos into the glassy air. The room in my mind with the blinds drawn where we nearly injure each other, crawling into the shawl of the other's body. Thank you, when I just say it plain, we fuck each other dumb. And you, again, you, for the true kindness it has been for you to remain awake with me like this, nodding time to time and making that noise, which I take to mean yes, or I understand, or please go on, but not too long, or why are you spitting so much, or easy tiger, hands to yourself. I am excitable. I am sorry. I am grateful. I just want us to be friends now forever. Take this bowl of blackberries from the garden. The sun has made them warm. I picked them just for you. I promise I will stay on my side of the couch. And thank you, the baggie of dreadlocks I found in a drawer while washing and folding the clothes of our murdered friend. The photo in which his arm slung around the sign to the trail of silences. Thank you, the way before he died, he held his hands open to us. For coming back in a waft of incense or in the shape of a boy in another city looking from between his mother's legs, or disappearing into the stacks after brushing by, for moseying back in dreams where, seeing us lost and scared, he put his hand on our shoulders and pointed us to the temple across town. And thank you to the man all night long hosing a mist on his early bloomed peach tree so that the hard frost not waste the crop, the ice in his beard and the ghosts lifting from him when the warming sun told him sleep now. Thank you, the ancestor who loved you before she knew you by smuggling seeds into her braid for the long journey, who loved you before he knew you by putting a walnut tree in the ground, who loved you before she knew you by not slaughtering the land. Who, thank you, who did not bulldoze the ancient grove of dates and olives, who sailed his keys into the ocean and walked softly home, who did not fire, who did not plunge the head into the toilet, who said, stop, don't do that, who lifted some broken someone up, who volunteered. The way a plant, birth of the reseeding plant, is called a volunteer. Like the plum tree that marched beside the raised bed in my garden. Like the arugula that marched itself between the blueberries. Nary a bayonet, nary an army, nary a nation, which usage of the word volunteer, familiar to gardeners the wide world, made my pal shout, oh, and dance and plunge his knuckles into the lush soil before gobbling two strawberries and digging a song from his guitar made of wood from a tree. Someone maybe planted, thank you. Thank you, Zinnia and Gooseberry, Rebecca and Pawpaw, Ashmeats, Colonel, Coxcomb, and Scarlet Runner, Feverfew and Lemon Balm. Thank you, Knitbone and Sweetgrass and Sunchoke and False Indigo, whose petals stammered apart by bumblebees. Good Lord, please give me a minute. And Moonglow and Catkin and Crookneck and Painted Tongue and Seed Pod and Johnny Jump Up. Thank you, what in us rackets glad, what glad rackets us. And thank you to this knuckle-headed heart, this pelican heart, this gap-toothed heart flinging open its gaudy maw to the sky. Oh, clumsy, oh, bumblefucked, oh, giddy, oh, dumbstruck, oh, rickshaw, oh, goat twisting its head at me from my peach tree's highest branch, balanced, impossibly gobbling the last fruit, its tongue working like an engine, a lone sweet drop tumbling by some miracle into my mouth like the smell of someone I've loved. Heart like an elephant screaming at the bones of his dead. Heart like the lady on the bus dressed head to toe in gold, the sun shivering her shiny boots, singing Erykah Badu to herself, leaning her head against the window. And thank you too, the way my father, one time he came back in a dream by plucking the two cables beneath my chin like a bass fiddle strings and played me until I woke singing. No kidding, I was singing and smiling. Thank you. Thank you, stumbling into the garden where the Juneberry's flowers had burst open like the bells of French horns. The lily my mother and I planted oozed into the air. The bazillion ants labored in their earthen workshops below. The collard greens waved in the wind like the sails of ships. And the wasps swam in the mint bloom's viscous swill. And you. And you. Again, you. For hanging tight, dear friends. I know I can be long-winded sometimes. I just want so badly to rub the sponge of gratitude over every single thing, including you, which, yes, gets awkward. The little suds slipping into your eye. Soon it will be over, which is precisely what the child in my dream said. Holding my hand and pointing at the roiling sea in the sky, hurtling our way like so many buffalo, who said, it's much worse than we think. And sooner. To whom I said, no duh, child in my dreams. What do you think this singing and shuddering is? What this screaming and reaching and dancing and crying is, other than loving what every second goes away? Goodbye, I mean to say. And thank you every day.
This is fun, the drama of like putting these mics on.
Hi.
How are you?
I'm good. How are you?
I'm good.
Good.
Thank you.
Yeah,
you're welcome. Hey, thanks.
You're very welcome.
That was amazing. Yeah. It's hard to say thank you enough. And thank you. Okay. Anyway, you just said it for like so long, so I'm gonna ask you a question. I'm like, it's so hard. Okay. So here's my question. I don't know how you knew I was going to ask you a question about inefficiency, but you were right. In Inciting Joy, you write about the process of organizing a community orchard.
Yeah.
And you say the inefficiency, the incompetence, the ineffectiveness, the dismal rate of production, the off-paskness, the wandering, the flabbiness, the consensusing, which I accidentally have down as consensus-sing, the play, the listening, the dreaming, were all just ways of being together. And so what I wanted to ask you was, how is inefficiency and incompetence part of the type of being together that poetry or essays asks us to do? And how is it part of the writing process?
Oh, beautiful. Beautiful. I was recently having a conversation with the writer Kimberly Johnson, beautiful poet and translator, and we were talking about like this silly idea of like, you know, immortal art that lasts forever, which to me is just a dumb fucking thing. It's just like it's a dumb aspiration, and in some ways it approaches the brutal. And she was saying, it was very interesting talking to her because she's a classicist, you know, but she was like, yeah, I don't care much about that notion of like stuff that will quote unquote last, stand the test of time, they say.
Yeah.
But more she was saying this thing that I thought was so beautiful, which is that the thing that poetry does that does seem to transcend time, and I would say anything that requires, well, I'll say the thing first and then, she said that there's a kind of attentiveness, a kind of attention that must be paid in the process of making a poem or reading a poem, which is itself a kind of, you know, does transcend time in a way.
Yeah.
And I would say that the way that it transcends time is because it makes you so close to another person's dreaming or breathing, mm-hmm. which a poem is a kind of archive of someone's breathing. If you become intimate with that, then you become intimate with some part of them, their breathing, or, you know, some process, at which point you've ceased to be yourself. Mm. And in a way, you might even say that at which point you've become joined in a way that you would say, okay, there is a kind of immortalness to it, or I would say something more like a kind of profound joining to it.
Yeah.
Yeah. That doesn't answer your question. So let me answer your question. But it made me think that. I feel like, you know, essays by their nature, I think, are, when I think of essays that are sort of exploratory, by their nature, essays mean to attempt, to try, the trial, all that stuff. But they are in the process of sort of coming to understand something that they do not understand,
right.
which is a very different mode of essaying for younger folks anyway. Than like having a thesis and then going about proving your thesis.
Right.
If you have a thesis, well, fuck it, you know it, right? You did it. But if you have an inquiry, a question, then it seems like you have an essay. And in order to sort of wander around in something, if you're actually going to sort of ask a question in any kind of meaningful way, also in being in a relationship, if I'm going to ask you a question in any meaningful way, I can't know the answer.
Yeah.
And I have to be willing, terrifying though it might be, to be like, I don't know the answer.
Right.
You know, that's a kind of, it seems like that's a process of being in, you know, writing, but it's also a process of being in a relationship, you know? Yeah. Which is why it's terrifying to be in relationships.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. And I was thinking, yeah, when we were sitting down earlier and talking about like Q&As and the like nervousness around that comes up, I was just thinking about the like vulnerability of listening and
totally.
How like, but that's, you know, just was scared about that. I want to.
Well, let me just say too. Yeah. And I was saying, I was joining you in that thing. I was like, reading to me is not very nervous making, but the being an interlocutor or being an introducer fucking terrifies me. Yeah. I'm afraid I'm going to fuck it up.
Yeah.
You know, I'm going to let someone down and all that stuff. But the other thing is that there's some mode often when we're on these stages and when we're like doing a thing that we're supposed to be really efficient. Like
right.
silence is a kind of danger, or like wandering, or stumbling around, or like not knowing, or like, you know, all of those things that are actually the things that make us creatures.
Yeah.
We're not supposed to do that.
No.
So let's do that.
That's too scary. I wrote down my question. Thank you very much.
82 questions.
Hope you're ready to sit a little longer. Okay, but the question I actually wanted to ask you that I wrote down was, I wanted to know how you resist certainty, especially because you're someone who is revisiting a lot of the same topics over and over again, like joy and caring. And like, for me, sometimes it's like, as a person, it can be easy to be like, joy, I know about joy, I love joy.
Yeah.
Or like, I know about beauty, that's beautiful.
Totally.
And then, you can lose it. So how do you keep that uncertainty about something that's so important to you, you know, when it's a value?
Yeah. Great question. I just don't believe that I'm to the bottom of it, of anything.
Yeah.
I don't believe that I'm to the, I mean, there's probably some things that I think I'm at to the bottom of, like, you know, I feel like I can instruct, even though I can instruct someone on how to shoot a foul shot. And I think I would feel very much like, yeah, it's kind of like this.
I'm like,
you know, but, but I feel no certainty that tomorrow or 2 weeks from now or 2 years from now, I'm going to have the same notion of what constitutes the joyful.
Mm.
Or the beautiful, or the delightful or any of those things. And partly I have that, I think, from the evidence of having lived and being like, oh, those things that I used to think were, maybe I would have said that was delightful. Now I don't necessarily think that. This is another thing that maybe is, and it connects to your other question too about the wandering and the inefficiency, is that the most interesting writing, again, it's the same most interesting relating or, you know, being with, is a process of unknowing myself. I think I know some, I relate, and then I've changed. I no longer know it in the same way. I try my damnedest and I don't always succeed.
Through
like plow through the world with what I know. Mm. I try hard not to do that. I probably fuck that up all the time in my life, but on the page, that's a place maybe where we get to practice it in this other kind of way. Like it's a kind of laboratory of coming to unknow ourselves again and again and again and again. Mm. Which is inefficient.
Right.
You know?
Yeah.
It's inefficient.
You have to ask questions.
Yeah.
And
yeah. You have to go like this and go like that. And there's not a straight line.
That's so interesting. Cause I think sometimes, like for me, with thinking about things like joy and delight, like it's easy from sometimes I have this feeling of like, I lost, like I'll have you like, I found it.
Yeah, yeah.
And then I'll be like, I lost it. And lots of times that feels like a moment that's horrible. You know what I mean?
Yeah,
and I'm like, the thing that caused me joy before is not causing me joy again.
Totally,
oh God.
Totally.
But when you say it like this, I'm like, well, that's amazing because that means I get to keep being surprised by joy and keep having wonder.
That's it.
And I don't have to know.
That's it.
So
that's
thank
it.
You.
Yeah. You're welcome.
Okay. Well, I also want to talk to you. This feels related too. I heard you talking in an interview recently about the relationship between disobedience and delight and wonder. Inefficiency is disobedience these days, right? And we were also been talking about the classroom.
Yeah.
So I guess I'm wondering how you inculcate. I rushed myself. I wrote down that word and I was like, wow. You inculcate delight and disobedience and wonder in a classroom, which is not meant to be a place of disobedience.
Totally. I know. I love the idea of me inculcating, first of all. I think I don't. I mean, I think I probably, let me just talk, see if I can talk through, because I want to write about this and maybe I can blunder through it a little bit first in front of all of you. The thing about delight and disobedience, I feel like delight, like wonder, it requires that we are capable of being surprised. So often delight, in my experience, you know, so often delight is something that, I mean, a couple things, but one is that it alerts you to something you didn't know something, like I didn't know how awesome those pants were with like the flowers on the bottom. I was like, whoa, awesome pants, you know, where, you know, how could I get some, you know, or how maybe I could make them. And it's sort of like, that is the experience of like seeing something anew. But in order to see something anew, you have to not know, you know, but you also have to, I think there's something about like being prepared to sort of know that other people don't know too. So there's some way that I think, and I don't think I'm trying to sort of just like make delight a more serious subject.
Serious.
I think it. There's some way that delight, joy for sure, is in some way fundamentally sort of anti-authoritarian. Mm-hmm. Because it implicit is a kind of doubt. Mm. You know, a kind of doubt, not of like a fundamental thing like connection. I think of delight as kind of these like flickerings of connection. Joy is like the practice of connection, which is mycelial and constant. Delight, someone help me with this definition. Some dude at a Q&A. But delight is sort of the flickering of that. But in order for that, you know, so connection is fundamental, and I don't think you have to doubt that. But I think the thing that we have to doubt and practice together, which is kind of like our study, doubting is the severing of that connection. Again and again and again, the sort of lie that suggests that we're not fundamentally connected, which a kind of authoritarianism would need us to be, need us to believe in it as opposed to each other.
Right.
So that's sort of, I completely forgot your question.
Okay. You're on track.
Ballpark. It's
about delight and authority or disobedience to authority.
Yes, yes, yes.
And then in the classroom, in the place of obedience and authority.
Totally.
Or and unobedience, you know, like
yeah,
both. Like
it's, yeah,
like,
absolutely.
Yeah.
So when we were talking the other day at dinner, I was so happy some of the sort of practices that you were talking about in your classroom, which I was just like, I want to take your class, you know? And, but it was, there's a number of things that I think in a classroom that you could immediately sort of eliminate obedience as a quality. Mm-hmm. Like what happens if obedience or like all of those words, what are those terrible fucking words? Like, obedience or compliance or all those things that you're supposed to be a good student, to be a good citizen, to be a good da 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 da.
Right.
Horror, all of it. And so what if we just make classrooms in places that are kind of like, you know, about that?
Yeah, I mean, make the rest of the student here.
Yeah, right, exactly, exactly. What if we make places in inside, you know, in the midst of that or outside of that, if it's inside of it and we're doing this, it's going to be a kind of outside of it, actually, maybe. Where that thing of obedience or that thing of compliance is not a question. Like where that is not a value. That is not an aspiration at all. The aspiration is sort of a mutual and abiding regard for one another's questions. What if that was a classroom?
Yeah.
Yeah, we're going to gather together. We're going to care for one another's questions. You know, and in the process, in this class, it's going to be, we're going to make poems and stuff out of it too. Poem type things or whatever we think we ought to be making. You know, it would, and there's all, you know, like grading itself is a way to sort of make people to, no matter what you feel about it, if you grade, the first question of the class is going to be evaluation and hierarchy. I think I could be wrong. It seems pretty prominent, you know. But if you can eliminate some of those things, which, you know, I have tenure, so everyone gets an A's in my classes. But you know, to the extent that we can gather and not be evaluating one another, but really be wondering together and caring for that wonder, then I think the idea of like being disobedient, then it'd be like, well, what are you being disobedient to? Like, all right, you know, like no matter, like, okay, you didn't write your poem. All right. Good, you know, or I didn't like turn something in. I didn't tell you had to turn anything in. Or I didn't like whatever. It's like, okay, it's just like it. I can't quite imagine, you know what I mean? It takes it off the table. Yeah. And I think maybe it also trains us or teaches us or inculcates us. It asks us the question of like, what does it mean to actually be together?
Yeah.
As opposed to like be trying to control each other or something.
And I feel like it's a practice, like back to practice, like it is a practice, like it is something, at least I feel like I'm practicing every day. And when you're talking about like care and questions, back to like Q&A nervousness, I feel like that's in the classroom too. Like making that place where people feel cared for enough to not know and to ask and not feel evaluated.
That's exactly it. Yeah, that's beautiful. That's beautiful. Yeah, because if you don't feel cared for to expose your not knowingness, which is probably the fundamental part of ourselves.
Yeah.
That we don't know and that we're changing. Hmm. We're going to, I mean, the goal of the classroom is like so much to prove that you are sort of a fixed, you know, and to perpetually getting a little bit more fixed. That's like, yeah. And so it's like, well, what if we don't, not only do I not care if you're fixed, I don't believe it. Mm-hmm. I don't think that's a thing to aspire to. I think the thing to aspire to is some kind of embrace of your and our changing.
Yeah.
Which you can fight all the fuck you want, but you're still gonna fucking change and die.
Yeah.
The rest of us are too, you know? So we might as well kind of be curious and tender toward each other about it.
Yeah. Yeah. That's so wonderful. Not to say like, is it time for audience questions? Is why I'm cutting myself off from the thousand things I wanna say. Yeah.
We could talk for a long time.
Take like one audience question.
Oh my God. Okay, I probably talked too long. Who has a question?
I have to bring the mic to you.
Okay, I'm sorry. I robbed it.
Oh, you're good.
for like one of my favorite authors.
Oh, thank you.
Things that I really love.
Yep.
Oh, thank you. One of the things I really love about your work, and I mean, hearing you read it aloud was absolutely amazing, was just like, when you read, it's like you get carried away and you really get caught up in these moments of joy. And when you write, there's so many hyphens, but in like the best way of like, it's kind of like when you're a kid and you're talking to someone about like, oh my gosh, I did this at recess, and it brings you back to those moments. So I'm just wondering, in your writing, but also in your living, how do you resist like the urge to edit and control? Because when I read your writing, there's like such a sense of freedom of just letting yourself like go with such a beautiful stream of consciousness. So as a writer and as a student myself, I just want to know, like, how do you do that? Are you just like really like go with the flow? How do you
do that?
How do you prevent yourself
from falling? Great question. I edit like hell. That's kind of how it is. You know, I love that question. And people will sometimes crack on me a little bit and they'll be like, you really like your work, don't you? You know, because I'm working on it, because I'll be laughing a little bit, or I'll be like enjoying it, as you noted, like I'll be enjoying it. And I don't enjoy usually, I mean, I enjoy somewhat the first drafts, but it's like by the 30th draft, it's after many, many, many revisions that part of why I'm enjoying it is because I got to the point in the revision where it became unfamiliar to me in a way. So that when I read it, I'm like, damn, you did that, you know? And also like you did that, I should also say, it's not like, oh, you did that. It's like, oh, you joined up with something and it happened. Hot damn, you know? So that's a little bit how I would say that. I also want to say this other thing. Does that make sense? Do you know what I'm saying? So it's like, it's a kind of the revision and the revision and the editing of the pieces toward a sound of going with the flow, you know? But if you read my first drafts, you'd be like, don't go with the flow anymore. You gotta interrupt that flow, dude. I'm kind of like working on, I don't know what it is, and I've been talking, we talked at dinner about it, I don't know if this is a thing, but a little book called Book Tour, because I'm on a book tour. And I've been like, my dear partner, I read her everything, and some of this is just like really tedious. It's just like deeply boring, you know? And she's still like, okay, so what is this? It's funny. And I try not to get my feelings hurt, you know? I'm like, hey, it's not great. It's not great. But anyway, but something that I realized in the process, and this, I don't quite know what this means yet, but it might be instructive or useful, is that I noticed that when I'm writing this, I go, like I have my little notebook and I'm right by hand, and I'm convinced that I'm a better thinker by hand now than other modes of technology or writing. And I go to the page almost like I'm gonna go like see something exciting by someone I don't know. It's like, oh shit, I can't wait to read what Ross is gonna write. It's that feeling. And it's like, I noticed it. I once had that feeling the other way, where I felt like I was reading Brian Blanchfield, the essayist and poet Brian Blanchfield. If you haven't read his book, Proxies, Jesus. And I remember reading it for like 2 or 3 hours one day, and I thought that I'd been writing for 2 or 3 hours. It's interesting. And it's a kind of like analogous, or like, I don't know, opposite or something related experience, where I'm reading these things like, what's going to happen? What's good? Like, I don't know myself. And that to me is kind of like a good, that feels like a good sign that I'm approaching the page really being like, you don't know, you're not in control, you know? Like, you got all this chops from like writing a lot and practicing, but you really are approaching the page as a way of coming to find something, which is also to say coming to be unknown to yourself. Does that make sense? Et cetera. Yeah. Thank you so much. It's been so nice. And thank you.
Yeah.
Thank you so much, Ross, for such an amazing reading. Arrow for facilitating the Q&A. Thank you, Amanda, for your introduction, and to Claudia for co-hosting on Zoom. As a reminder, Ross will give a craft talk tomorrow from 10 to 11 a.m. titled Getting Lost. All are welcome to join in person in Angel Hall 3222, or you can join us via Zoom at the same link as tonight's event. If you'd like to receive notifications about our events in the future, you can sign up for our email list on the sign-up sheet on the table right outside the auditorium door, or if you're on Zoom, by following the link dropped in the chat. We also have a table right outside the auditorium where you can buy Ross's books from Literati Bookstore and have him sign your copy before you go. Many thanks again for coming out, and enjoy the rest of your evening.
Hi, thank you. So good.